It's Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science, chemistry PhD, skincare nerd, and sunscreen connoisseur. I've had a lot of people ask me to explain the nitty-gritty behind how sunscreen ingredients work, and I warned everyone it would be super nerdy and really quite complicated, but you all said it was fine, so here it is, the fine details, the deep dive into how sunscreen ingredients work. If you're more interested in finding a sunscreen that works for you, this is probably not the right video. I have a whole playlist of sunscreen videos that I've linked in the description as well. Now, don't freak out, but this is physical chemistry. It is upper high school / undergraduate level chemistry. I'm going to try to explain it very simply, so you should be able to follow it even if you don't remember anything from chemistry in school. I also have a written version of this linked in the video description, so if you prefer to learn by reading, or if you zone out and you don't know what's going on, have a look at that. As always, if you like talking about the science behind beauty products, click the like, the subscribe, and the notification bell so you don't miss any videos. As you all hopefully know, sunscreens contain active ingredients that reduce the amount of UV hitting your skin. Remember that UV is a type of light, it's higher energy and shorter wavelength than visible light, and there are two types of UV that we care about because that's what hits our skin from the sun: UVB, which is higher energy, shorter wavelength, and UVA, which is lower energy, longer wavelength. The shorter the wavelength, the higher the energy. There are two main categories of sunscreen ingredients, organic and inorganic, which is sometimes called chemical and physical, even though those aren't really good descriptors. Organic sunscreens are the ones with complicated names, and they contain lots of carbon atoms joined together. Inorganic sunscreens, which are sometimes called mineral sunscreens, are zinc oxide and titanium dioxide. I talk about which ones you should choose in my chemical versus physical sunscreen video, so if you're more interested in the applications of sunscreen, check that one out. I'm going to start by talking about how organic sunscreen ingredients work. Overall, what they do is absorb UV energy and then convert it to more harmless forms of energy, mostly heat. The law of conservation of energy says that you can't create or destroy energy, you can only convert it to other forms. So that's exactly what these sunscreen molecules do. They're like little factories that take in the UV energy and convert it to something that isn't going to make your skin massively age or give you cancer. The way that they do this is with electrons. Chemicals all have electrons inside them, and these electrons, depending on which chemical they're in, can absorb different types of energy and convert it into other forms. So you can imagine that your sunscreen molecule is sitting on your skin. It's very low energy, it's very stable, it's perfectly happy sitting there. Now, if the right type of UV light comes along, the right wavelength, the electrons in that sunscreen molecule can absorb that UV. So now it's taken in some energy, that sunscreen molecule is very excited. So it was down here, now it's up here, and it's very energetic. Excited is actually the technical term for this. Things don't like to have a lot of energy, so this sunscreen molecule isn't very stable. It wants to get rid of that energy and go back to where it was before. So the electrons in that sunscreen molecule convert that energy to something else and poop it out. The sunscreen goes back to where it was before. This is called relaxation. Again, it is a technical term. Now that it's back in its lower energy form, it's free to absorb more UV and then convert that to something else, and this can happen again and again. This is actually a similar process to why black things get hot in the sun. Black dye is really good at absorbing visible light, and so it absorbs that light, the electrons in it get excited, and then it releases that energy back out as heat. Fireworks also work this way, so the electrons in fireworks absorb the heat energy from the explosives, and then it releases that energy back out as light. That's actually why we have different colors. There are different chemicals inside the fireworks which release different colors of light. Now you might be wondering, what sorts of energy do sunscreen molecules release then? It depends on which sunscreen chemical you're talking about, but it is usually a combination of different types of energy. It can be vibrations which turn into heat as those vibrations knock into other molecules and those vibrations get passed on. Heat is really just vibrations. It can be lower energy forms of light, so remember you can't create energy out of nothing. So that sunscreen molecule might convert part of the UV into a lower energy form of light and the rest of it into heat. Sunscreens can release infrared radiation which turns into heat in your skin, visible light, or even lower energy forms of UV. The UV can also turn into chemical energy, and what that means is breaking bonds. Sometimes this is reversible, so the sunscreen molecule can keep working, so the bond breaks and unbreaks as it converts the UV energy into chemical energy, just like we talked about before. But sometimes it's not reversible, so that means you don't get your original molecule back, so your sunscreen slowly decomposes and stops working over time. This is what happens when a sunscreen is photo unstable. When formulators try to make a sunscreen ingredient more photo stable, basically what they're doing is trying to convince that molecule to convert the UV energy into other forms of energy rather than breaking the irreversible bonds. So with all this talk of heat, you might be wondering, does your skin heat up? The answer is maybe a tiny bit, but the amount of heat is tiny compared to the amount that you're getting from other things. If you're wearing sunscreen and you can feel your skin get hot in the sun, it's probably not the sunscreen and the UV. It's probably the infrared light and the visible light turning into heat in your skin. Sunlight is only about 3-7% UV compared to 44% visible light and 53% infrared. Your skin also might be irritated by the sunscreen, which can make it go hot. But it's almost definitely not the UV you're feeling. If you do the conversion, your skin temperature might go up by less than 1 degree. There's probably a bigger difference between this part of your arm and this part of your arm right now. So, organic sunscreen molecules absorb UV, but why do some of them absorb UVA and some of them absorb UVB and some of them absorb both? Let's have a look at their structures. The first thing you'll notice is probably that a lot of them have rings. These are pentagons and hexagons. They also have this pattern of having a double bond, then a single bond, then a double bond. Sometimes it's in rings, sometimes it's not, and this is called conjugation. Conjugation gives the electrons in the molecule a special property, which is that they can run around a bit. This is called delocalization. The bigger your conjugated pattern, the more delocalized these electrons are, so they can run around more, and they can absorb smaller amounts of energy. By default, if you have a molecule with no conjugation, it can probably only absorb UVC. In other words, the energy gap between the lower level and the higher level matches the UVC range. This is completely useless for us because UVC doesn't reach us on Earth. If it's a smaller molecule with conjugation, then this gap gets a bit smaller and it goes into the UVB range. If the conjugated pattern gets bigger, then this gap gets even smaller and we get into the UVA range. So you'll notice that the UVB filters tend to be a bit smaller than the UVA filters. If you have rings, you also get more delocalization, which is why you see all these rings in sunscreen chemicals. If you make this gap even smaller, then it's going to absorb visible light, and this is actually how you get dyes. If you look at dye molecules, these absorb some of the visible light, and the rest of the color bounces into your eye, and so you see it as a color. So this is acid violet 43, which is what's currently in my hair. It absorbs yellow, and so you see it as purple. So apart from conjugation, other things on the sunscreen molecule can also change the amount of delocalization. Oxygen and nitrogen atoms can add extra electrons, so this extends how far the electrons can run. If atoms on the molecule can interact with other atoms and form rings, this also increases the area where these electrons can run. So for example, let's look at avobenzone. Avobenzone has two forms, and these can turn into each other. If you look at the conjugation pattern, this one has a much smaller one. You can see that it breaks in the middle where we have two single bonds next to each other. But in this version, we have a much bigger pattern. It pretty much takes up the whole molecule. So this version, which has less delocalization, absorbs a shorter wavelength. This one, which has a bigger delocalization pattern, absorbs a longer wavelength. This whole idea where the wavelength of UV that a particular sunscreen molecule absorbs is linked to the amount of delocalization also explains a lot of the things that people keep on saying about the importance of the formula. For example, if you have an acidic filter at a high pH, it gets a negative charge. This means that there's more electrons, more delocalization, so it will absorb a longer wavelength. If you have a basic filter, these usually have nitrogens on their structure. If you put them at a low pH, they'll actually get a positive charge, and this shortens the amount of space that the electrons have to run around, and so they'll absorb a shorter wavelength. Solvents can also interact with either the lower state or the higher state, and this will lower their energy. If the solvent interacts with the lower state, that's called the ground state, that lower state will decrease in energy, and so that gap gets bigger. That means that the sunscreen molecule will absorb higher energy UV, a shorter wavelength. If it interacts with the top state, the excited state, then that will get lower, and so now you get a smaller gap. It'll absorb lower energy, longer wavelength. For octinoxate, its main UV absorbance can actually change by 20 nanometers just by changing the solvent. So let's ungracefully switch for a moment to these graphs that you might have been seeing around. Each line shows the UV absorbance for a specific sunscreen ingredient. I'm going to get rid of everything except avobenzone for a moment. The way we read this graph is the horizontal axis is the wavelength. As we go from left to right, the wavelength gets longer, and so we're going from higher energy UVB to lower energy UVA. The vertical line is absorbance, and so the higher the line is, the more of that wavelength it's absorbing. So avobenzone absorbs some UVB, it absorbs a bit more UVA, it reaches a maximum at 357 nanometers, so it's absorbing the most there, then it drops down again as we keep on going through the UVA region. That's why we call it a UVA filter. It does absorb a bit of UVB, but it mostly absorbs UVA. A broad spectrum ingredient means that it absorbs more wavelengths, and so you'll see a fatter, chunkier curve. Tinosorb S's curve, for example, looks like this, so it absorbs both UVA and UVB. It is a broad spectrum filter. Now you might be wondering, if a sunscreen molecule absorbs UV that matches the energy gap, and we only have one sunscreen ingredient, why is it absorbing all these wavelengths? Shouldn't it just absorb one single wavelength? Shouldn't we get a UV dot rather than a UV curve? Why is it absorbing 357 and 360 and 350 nanometers? Why isn't it just absorbing one single wavelength? That's because in real life, molecules move around, and in a single drop of sunscreen, you have billions and billions and billions and billions of sunscreen molecules. So there'll be billions that look like this, and like this, and like this, and like this. And all of these will have slightly different delocalization, and so they all have slightly different energy gaps, and so all of them will absorb slightly different wavelengths. So the energy gap diagram actually looks a bit more like this. There are lots of different energy gaps possible, and some of these are more likely to happen than others. So there's more of the 357 nanometer transition, there's less of the 350, less of the 340, and so on. And this happens with every sunscreen ingredient, which is why we get lots of different curves rather than lots of dots. All of these molecules absorb lots of different wavelengths in different amounts. Now, some of these curves are a bit more complicated. So Tinosorb S, for example, it has a double hump. It's because it actually has two overlapping humps. Tinosorb S and a lot of the newer sunscreen filters, as well as some of the older ones, have more complicated structures. So if you look at their delocalization systems, they look a bit more 2D rather than 1D. They look more like a shape rather than just a line. So there's more than one possible electronic transition that can happen. There's one in the UVA and one in the UVB region. Both of these transitions are again a bit fuzzy, and so again you get two curves rather than two dots. Now, if we look at the curves of different sunscreen filters, you'll see that some of these are higher and some of these are lower. The higher the line, the more it absorbs in that particular wavelength. So if it's high in the UVB, it absorbs UVB more strongly. If it's higher in the UVA, it absorbs UVA more strongly. These are all comparing the same mass concentration of the sunscreen. They're all 1% in ethanol. So this is very roughly reflected in the actives in an actual sunscreen product. But you do have to remember that these curves don't completely reflect what happens in a sunscreen product. These are for the sunscreen filters dissolved in ethanol. When you actually put a sunscreen on your skin, the ethanol evaporates pretty quickly. The sunscreen also dries down into a film rather than floating around in liquid, which is what's happening in these curves. And so that also changes the optical properties of the film. And remember, there are also lots of things like pH and solvent that could change those energy gaps. And so that means that the curve might shift to the left, might shift to the right, might shift up and down a bit. It gets even more complicated if you put more than one filter into a single sunscreen. If you have a UVB filter and a UVA filter, then having them both in there means that you can get a broad spectrum curve. So that means for the overall sunscreen, the final curve will look very different from these. It'll be sort of like you add them together. When I say add together, I don't mean you can just sum them up. The final curve can be a bit tricky to predict. The filters might interact synergistically, so the curve ends up higher than you'd expect. They might change each other's delocalization, and so the curve might shift left and right. There's lots and lots of possibilities that you can't really predict. Again, these curves are for 1% in a solution, not whatever percentage in your actual sunscreen product. If you have a higher percentage, the curve will go up because you have more sunscreen molecules on your skin. The sunscreen molecules can absorb more UV, and so you have higher absorbance. Another thing to notice is that it doesn't matter how many filters you have to build that final curve. What matters is just that final curve. I've seen some skincare science influencers say that you need more filters for redundancy, but that's not how UV absorbance works. It's like saying that a 2-meter ladder made of steel, aluminium, and wood will get you higher than a 2-meter ladder just made of steel. They both get you 2 meters. It doesn't matter what materials they're made of. Now onto the inorganic sunscreens, zinc oxide and titanium dioxide. Back in the day, the cosmetics industry thought that they worked just by scattering UV. It was actually written into the 1978 FDA legislation and then taken out when they revised it in 1999. So that's probably why this is so widespread. But scientists have known that it works by mostly absorbing UV for quite a long time. And scientists keep pointing it out in peer-reviewed papers, but it's just one of those myths that won't die. The way that zinc oxide and titanium dioxide work is very much like an organic sunscreen. So they have electrons that can absorb UV and get excited into a higher state. Then when those electrons relax back down, that UV energy converts to more harmless forms. So heat or light or lower energy UV or infrared. But zinc oxide and titanium dioxide are inorganic. That means they don't have carbon atoms in their structure, so they don't have the same ability to make conjugated systems. Instead, what they have is called a band gap structure. So here is what zinc oxide looks like. There are a lot of atoms packed closely together, which means lots of electrons, and so those electrons can interact with each other, so we get lots and lots of different energy levels for lots of different electrons. So instead of a low energy level and a high energy level, you have a low energy band made up of lots of levels, and a high energy band made up of lots of levels. The smallest gap between them from the highest low energy level to the lowest high energy level is the minimum absorbance, so the smallest energy gap that can be absorbed. So that's the minimum energy or longest wavelength they can absorb, and they can absorb pretty much every UV energy level higher than this, so every shorter wavelength of UV. And that's because of that band structure, the fact there's so many different levels, there's lots of different energy transitions that can happen. So that's why the absorbance curves look like they suddenly go off a cliff. That cliff matches the shortest energy gap. Now this absorbance explains about 95% of how they work. The other approximately 5% is scattering. Scattering is when the UV comes in and the particle changes the direction that it's going in. It doesn't actually usually bounce backward, it usually bounces forwards. So it keeps on going, but at a different angle. So a lot of the time UV light actually gets scattered towards your skin, which is actually okay because it means that it takes a longer path, it's not taking the shortest path anymore, and that means there's a higher chance of that UV hitting another particle and getting absorbed. Now, inorganic sunscreens are pretty complicated because you can get different particle sizes. In sunscreens, the particle size is usually really small, less than 200 nanometers. That's because scattering is proportional to diameter. The bigger it is, the more it scatters, the less it absorbs. It's not only UV that gets scattered, it's also visible light. And so the larger the particle, the more scattering you get, the more visible light gets scattered into your eye from the sunscreen, and you see it as a white cast. There's also the fact that only atoms at the surface of the particle can absorb UV. If you have a big particle and you break it down into smaller particles, you get more surface exposed, and so you get greater UV absorbance. Longer wavelengths also get scattered more than shorter wavelengths. So even though the particles are mostly absorbing the UV, they can also at the same time be scattering visible light. Zinc oxide absorbs both UVA and UVB. Titanium dioxide mostly absorbs UVB and mostly scatters UVA, but it does depend on the particular particle size of the sunscreen. I'm going to leave it there. If you got to this point, congratulations, well done, I am very proud. Here is your prize, the cutest thing I've seen in a long time. These two penguins both had their partners pass away, but every night they meet up to watch the city lights and comfort each other for hours. If you have any questions, drop them down below and I'll try my best to answer them. If you like the video, click the like and subscribe. You can also follow me on Instagram at @labmuffinbeautyscience and check out my blog for more nerdy beauty content. See you next time to nerd out more.